This is the greatest flash trigger ever made, the Fusion TLC Raven. I'm gonna tell you what makes it so amazing to use in the studio or out on location with flashes or strobes. And then, because this is an unsponsored, unbiased review, I'm going to ruin all of your dreams for it. The rear display of the Raven is vertical, which makes it easy to access when the camera is on a tripod at eye level. Press a button on the side to turn it on, and it indicates when it detects communications with a camera. You can see the main screen shows A, B, C, D for four different strobes. All of these are currently off, but if I push this button here, it will turn it on. So here you can see I am controlling two separate lights. To adjust the power output, I'll lightly touch one of these buttons until the letter is selected in the middle, and then I can adjust it up or down with the main dial here. To turn a strobe on or off, push hard on one of these buttons. To simply select a strobe, lightly push the button. It's a little inconsistent. Now I can adjust multiple strobes at one time. For example, if I change my ISO and I need to raise the lights by one stop, I can do that for all the lights simultaneously. This is actually a really confusing user interface because you can see rotating the dial counterclockwise reduces all of the strobes, but this green indicator here rotates counterclockwise with it, which makes sense, but this indicator here rotates opposite the direction of the dial. I can also select or deselect lights by pressing them directly on the touchscreen. With lights selected, I can edit those one or more lights by pushing the settings button in the middle here. This allows me to configure whether it's manual or TTL. I can use a power tracking mode that automatically keeps the lights at a constant power output as my camera settings change, so I could change the ISO or the aperture or both of them and maintain a constant exposure. I could turn the modeling lights on, something that activates only after I take a picture. I can access some settings by swiping down from the top. Here you see this circular arrangement, not unlike an Apple Watch. The cloud here checks for updates online, connect by connecting to your Wi-Fi. This controls the brightness. This setting is cool. It shows you the amount of noise in each channel, with green being good and yellow or red being the worst. So you could work around Wi-Fi networks to ensure clean communication. This turns the flash trigger's light on and off. You can use it as a fill light or use it just to make things a little brighter for the sake of focusing. This controls whether there are sounds like beeping. And this bottom one controls the brand of light that you are using. You can mix Godox and PocketWizard or Profoto or Palsy Buff in case you have two different brands of light. Going back to the main screen, we can swipe up to have yet a second set of settings. I find this very confusing because the arrangement is changed. It's like it was made by a separate developer. And wait, this is even more confusing. There's a separate brand icon here, and it has the exact same menu item that was on the previous page. I'm not sure why that's duplicated or why there's different user interfaces. You can see there's also a local light setting here, which has different settings than we saw in the local light setting on the swipe down menu. Here you can configure how the local light is used for autofocus assist, manual focus assist, or just fill light. You can also adjust the color temperature here. As well as the brightness. You can set a wake schedule so it always wakes up at the same time of day, and I cannot imagine why I'd do that. You can use an intervalometer, which will cause your camera to fire. This happens through the hot shoe on Canon cameras. If you use a Nikon camera, you have to connect a separate USB cable to trigger the camera. I don't know why you would do this, since all modern cameras have intervalometers built in. There are yet more settings on a separate page here, including sound, which again seems to be duplicated from the swipe down page, and about menu. The brightness, which is again a duplicate setting. The time, which I guess only matters if you use the wake up time. And of course you can connect to a Wi-Fi network, which is so cool because that allows you to download updates directly to it. Swipe from right to left and it brings up the camera triggering menu so that multiple triggers can fire at the same time. That's useful in maybe sports scenarios where you need to take a picture of a fast action moment from multiple different cameras. Multi-camera triggering typically requires a separate expensive device, so it's nice that it's built into this, but it's not something I would ever use. On the side of the camera, there's a sync view button. This captures the shape of your flash output when you fire. And you can see right now it's in high speed sync. So let's turn that off. And now you can see I can adjust the delay between pressing the shutter and firing it. In theory, this allows you to increase your camera's sync speed from say 1/250th to something faster. However, in my experience and testing, I was never able to use a faster sync speed, so it wasn't actually worth the time I needed to put into it. First, I gotta applaud the people at Fusion TLC for like putting smart software in here. They clearly hired really great developers and they care about design more than any of my cameras, because I can literally download updates from the cloud through my Wi-Fi directly to this little flash trigger, but none of my cameras can do that. So Canon, Nikon, Sony, could you please just like buy this company to get the developers and use their software to make a real operating system for your cameras that's user friendly and includes these sort of user interface elements. But also I want that because I want you to take the radio transmitter triggering mechanism and build that directly into the camera, so I don't need some big dorky thing hanging off my hot shoe. Like, why is it not given that my camera can communicate to an external strobe? Of course that should be built in. Good news, bad news time. First, the good news. This is my favorite flash trigger ever. It is definitely what I will use. It is just a pleasure because the display is so nice. In fact, it's so good that it makes the rear screen on my Canon or my Sony just look bad. I don't know why we can't take this tech and put it into, you know, a $4,000 camera. Now for the bad news, and there's kind of a lot of it. The price is $450. And the way I use it, it doesn't do anything more than my standard Godox trigger, which costs like $50. But this sure looks and feels better, but is $400 worth it to look and feel a little bit better? I mean, to some of you, it might. To most of you, it probably won't. Now, this certainly does a lot more, and you are paying for those features, but in my case, they're features I'm not gonna use. I'm not going to use this as an intervalometer. It has a sound trigger in there where it'll like fire the camera and flashes that. I'm not gonna use that. I'm not going to trigger multiple cameras from that device. I don't need to use multiple different brands of strobes simultaneously. That's not something I care about. And I kind of am paying for all the sophistication that I'm not using. But I think what Fusion TLC did was they launched their high-end product first. And I suspect we will see lower end, less expensive products coming down the line soon. I also think a lot of the weird user interface problems that I talked about here are going to be fixed through firmware updates, which have been fast and frequent. So it's something I'm definitely going to keep my eye on. And I bet this review in particular will give them some useful feedback about things that they can improve. So I am excited about what it is today and what it's going to be in the future. And I'm definitely going to be following Fusion TLC closely to see what they do next. Right now, this is available for Canon and Nikon cameras. The Sony is like technically available, but I think you can't actually order. Anyway, Sony should be available soon. Fuji, Olympus, Panasonic, I don't know. I hope they come shortly thereafter. It has been 100% reliable. It has fired pretty much every time. I will say the hot shoe seems a little wobbly, but nonetheless, it was completely effective and efficient, and I never had any particular problems with it. It does not have a removable battery. It USB, micro USB charges, which I don't like for when everything, most of the things in my life are USB-C now, so I had to pull out an old cable to be able to charge it. But also, I had a shoot, and it had been in a drawer for a week, and the battery died while it was in the drawer. So if you are gonna stash it away, you pretty much need to plug it in, because the battery was dead, I couldn't do the shoot, and I didn't have time to wait for it to charge because it takes a while. It meant I had to postpone the entire shoot for the next day. I can live with it, but for professional devices, having just removable AA batteries like are in all my other flash triggers works perfectly fine for me. Here's how it compares to the native Godox triggers. You can see the original Godox trigger has a terrible 1970s Casio display and a really confusing user interface with two limited buttons. The top space on it is completely useless. The more modern Godox has dedicated buttons which allow you to more quickly select a given strobe, and then you can adjust the strobe power with this, and it actually works just fine. There's the Pro model of the Godox trigger, which has a bigger LCD display, but it's still very 1970s. It does allow you to access individual lights and then rapidly adjust them. And in a way, as far as just adjusting lights, either of these two maybe are even a little more efficient than the Raven, just because the physical buttons are a little easier. I actually find these two Godox triggers are the easiest to make simple adjustments to, which is all I ever do, because the buttons are very competent and simple. The Fusion TLC, of course, has a much more sophisticated display, but it's also much bigger than even the Pro model. The color display looks way better. Is it actually more useful or efficient? No, maybe not. To clarify, I tested this with studio strobes, with on-the-go flashes, Godox, and our old Palsy buff lights. I tested TTL and high-speed sync, and if the strobes supported those, then it seemed to work okay. So, like, checked off all the major boxes. There were just no main problems. Write a comment down below. I'm particularly curious if you think this is just, like, over-designed and over-engineered, or if you actually need some larger set of these features. Is $450 too much to pay for a super cool flash trigger? I'd like to hear down below. Don't forget to give me a like and subscribe to see more of our videos and turn on notifications. Thanks and bye.